back to your experience, if you were not a filmmaker, Oliver, how do you think you would have coped with what happened to you there? I mean, would you have found another avenue? Would you have flipped out? Or would you, to use the title of one of your own movies, become a natural-born killer? Seriously.
Well, when I came back from Vietnam, I was very, I was an angry young man and had violent thoughts. And I went through a period of adjustment. I was very lucky in the sense that I went to NYU Film School and I got a chance to make films, and that was a release, an artistic expression. And I did three Vietnam movies. So I think over the course of those three movies, I learned a lot more and I worked out some of my deepest feelings that I didn't even recognize at the time.
When you were in Vietnam, I mean, were you a natural-born killer?
No. 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 Killing came as a result of a process. They were shooting at us. We were losing men. And as I said, it was a combat situation in the jungle. But I did not... I think I did a good job when I killed because it saved men. And it was a tricky situation. I saved some people. And I did my job as a soldier. But I will always remember the man. I saw him up front, up very close. I saw his body after I killed him. He's still there, you know. But he was doing his job.
He's still there. Where?
I saw his. I mean, he's there as a spirit in my mind. Now, of course, we opened. You know, Americans fire wildly at times, so we fired a lot of rounds. So who knows what else we did? You know, we used to clear space in the jungle with machine gun fire and M79s and mortar fire. I mean, we fired a lot of indiscriminate shells, so there's a lot of casual and collateral damage.
I ask the question because you can help me clear up a mystery. You wrote this book in 1966, Oliver Stone, A Child's Night Dream. The year before you enlisted in Vietnam, the year before you saw combat. And it's fiction, but there's a chapter in here written before you went to Vietnam that is eerie and uncanny. It's titled Dear Mom. And I'm wondering, would you care to read this passage?
It's a letter I wrote, a fictional letter I wrote to my mother. I had not been in Vietnam yet. I had been in Vietnam as a teacher, and I had also been in the Merchant Marine in 1965.
Wait a minute, you'd been in Vietnam as
a
teacher?
Yeah. I went there as a teacher in 1965.
In what kind of school?
In Cholon Free Pacific Institute. It was a Catholic school teaching Chinese students in high school. And I was there for almost a year, and then I did the Merchant Marine as a wiper. I was a wiper.
What's that?
It's the lowest job on the ship. it's cleaning out the engine room, blowing the boilers. It's a great experience for me. But I came back to America. I actually went back to Yale a second time and dropped out a second time because I was writing this book and I wanted to be a novelist. I admired Mailer and Hemingway and Joyce and Jack London, and above all, Joseph Conrad. And I wanted to do something like this, and I wanted to be a novelist. It didn't succeed. The book was rejected, and that's when I went back. I said, the hell with this trying to be different, trying to be Oliver Stone. I was going to go back to my given birth name of William Oliver, and I went back into the Army, and I joined it as Bill Stone, William Stone. I wanted to be anonymous. I wanted to be, as I said in Platoon, I wanted to be like every other person. I didn't want any special breaks. I wanted to be just infantry. I didn't want to be an officer. I didn't want to be a lieutenant. I wanted to be just a PFC. And get it from the bottom. And if God, at that time, if God wanted to, if God had a meaning for my life, he'd sort it out. Otherwise, I'd be dead. That's my approach in 1967. I killed a man the other day. I suppose it was a great event in my life, something that since childhood, when with devotion I watched the violence on the television screen, I have always more or less lived with. Perhaps I expected too much because of and by itself, it was rather commonplace. Like bumping into someone at a subway turnstile on Lexington and 59th. I shot him out of a tree at 30 yards. I picked him out and fired seven rounds in mad succession until I was assured that he would utterly cease to breathe, to move, to exist. Whereupon, as if in pointed irony, I heard the cracking sound of breaking wood. He was tumbling from his nest like an unseen falling coconut, and came to a quiet halt on the firm intersection of two thick branches. A tangle of shrubbery hid all the emotional parts of his body. For a second, it felt deliciously good, I could almost have eaten it. I could almost have eaten it. Whatever this satisfied feeling was, something had fallen exactly into place like a bone comfortably cracking in the body. Good shot, Oliver. Good shot. It seemed so suddenly strange that without even touching him, I had brought him down like a buck. A light, delightful tickle pervaded my wrists, especially my right wrist, you know, the one I broke as a child. Yes, above all, it was the wrists which responded as if they themselves had hurled the bullet knife. A grim satisfaction possessed me. He was mine. I killed him. Me. Nobody else.
And this was written?
Yeah, it was written
a year before
yeah.
you went?
Yeah.
I mean, in some kind of perverse, weird way, did you go to Vietnam and live this?
Well, there's a lot of perverse and weird stuff in that book. It was really a coming to terms with Oedipal confusions of my mother and my father. And I had fantasies of war when I was young, a lot of them bred by movies and television and books. Hemingway had been a war-defined a man. So I was an adventurer, and I wanted, and I was desperately wanted to seek adventure, but I hadn't experienced it, a war. And that was the last frontier for me. So it became necessary somewhere when I was doing this book for me to say, I have to go back now. This is not good enough. I have to go all the way. So I went back and I enlisted at Whitehall Street there.